So the next presentation or talk will be by Mohammed Jabali. It is titled Aliens Beyond Western Christendom. Jabali is a multidisciplinary artist, writer, poet, illustrator, DJ, online marketer, and SEO, faculty member at the photography department of Bezalel Academy, and a lecturer on the internet as a public sphere and its role in contemporary art.
Okay, so this is the first time I'm giving this talk, so it's not going to be as polished as Rinaldo's talk. I'm going to
it's going to be a comment on Arab futurism nowadays with some historical references and what I think the relationships between the terms and conditions to produce art in our days and how it affects Arab futurism and how it affects Arab contemporary art in general. And how this creates a notion where, or a situation, where Arab contemporary art in general can't really deal with the main issues that can be in real interest of the people of the regions that it comes from. Now it's a bit contradictory to make this talk from, you know, the main colony of Western Christendom in the Middle East. So, and it's a main contradictory to try and make this talk as somebody who works and wants to work with, you know, Berlin, New York, and whatever. So trying to put a critique on the condition you also work in, it's a bit not a very easy subject. And most of the things I would ask other Arab futurist artists or other Arab artists to do, most probably they will have the condition to do better than I do. And I will explain as we go. So why Western Christendom, and what does that have to do with science fiction, and what's between the Western civilization and Western Christendom? We talk a lot about Orientalism and the figures of the Muslim or the Orient or the Arab in the popular Western media. But we less address the infrastructure in which the Western civilization was built on, and which is still serves many functions in our lives today. So I will go over some quotes from Gili Najjar article on secularism, Edward Said book on Orientalism, and Jalal Sadiq al-Adham reply to Edward Said on Orientalism as we speak. So Arab or Islamic nationalism lacks, in spite of its occasional use as a catchword, the concept of the divine right of a nation. It lacks a formative ethic. The later 19th century believe in mechanistic progress. So in a way, the Orient have been always portrayed and sketched as a place where there is no belief in mechanic progress, which from the beginning put any notion to deal with futuristic elements in like it's denied anyhow that the Orient could deal with any futuristic notions, given the fact that it's looked at as a place that has no understanding of mechanistic progress. On the other hand, this is exactly how secularism follows the notion of Western, like is built on notions of Orientalism. For like in this picture, the West is a notion of linear progress, while the Orient is a place with no sense of time or progress,
it's been always the same, it will always be the same. Let's say, of course, it's a 19th century thought and it's an 18th century thought, but I think it still affects many aspects of the world today. The Semites are rabid monotheists who produced no mythology, no art, no commerce, no civilization, only religion. And to come to this Gili Najjar quote, Semites, no longer the Jews, are nothing but a religion, the best and the worst of it. A more elaborate note needs to be, you know, given why no longer the Jews. The Jews becoming a nation, a Western entity, moving from being the Orient inside Europe to being the Western inside the Orient, but that's for another talk. What is a religion? It's first of all something that is essential to the Orientalist vision could be studied apart from the economics, sociology, and politics of the Islamic people. History, politics, and economics do not matter. Islam is Islam. The Orient is the Orient. Now, from here, I want to move to... I should have involved much more pictures, to be honest. It will be lacking a bit of in pictures, but there will be some. But Dune, yeah? Dune probably is the best, the most influential soft sci-fi. It's the bestseller in the 20th century. Anybody read, who read Dune in the, no? Who saw the movies? Okay, so that covers 70% and more from the audience. That's pretty it. Now, what I like about Dune is that it's a soft sci-fi, which usually I like. Sometimes even more than hard technology or sci-fis. And I think just because it focuses on the future of humankind rather on the future of human technology. Now, one of the main characteristics and aspects of this novel is that it really have unexplainable knowledge. Like, it's really unexplainable to understand how Frank Herbert could have even knew so much about Sufi Islam, Shia Islam, and involved all of this theme in his book. In a way, it shows that you could build pretty good picture just from sitting at home with a library. Which also, if you read the book, has something with Lisan al-Ghayb, with predicting the future, with sitting and imagining. Now, the desert is definitely one of the elements that keep repeating themselves in Dune and in many other sci-fis. Which is, you know, desert is most probably the most alien landscape we know on Earth. Like, we can't really live under the sea for long, but probably these two, like deep in the, under the sea and desert, are probably the most weird landscapes we will ever know. And it's not by chance that, you know, attaining or obtaining the knowledge of behaving in such a landscape, it could make you an alien of somehow, you know. So it explains a lot also, you know, all of this relationship between East and West, East and West, and, but you know, I think even if you succeeded Siberia, that makes you of an alien at the same, but we see less of Siberia in sci-fi, we see more of the desert. Now yet, even though that Dune is a mixture of Christian mythology, Kabbalah, Zen Buddhism, and mystical Islam, the Messiah is some sort of Lawrence of Arabia. Like the Messiah is the blonde guy who leaves the noble people, goes to the desert, becomes the Mahdi, and then comes back to the noble families to rule the world. Now that could have been a whole, you know, a whole resolution to the whole theological problem between Islam and Christianity in a way. But that's a Christian fantasy, you know. Because like Muhammad has the same story of Paul Atreides. It's just that he's not Lawrence of Arabia, he's not the blonde guy, he just was born in the desert. And this is the main, but he has a pretty similar biography. Now why I choose the image from Jodorowsky's Dune, because I think the greatest sci-fi is yet to be made, and the greatest sci-fi which will succeed in to deal with religion and the image of the Arab and the Orient is still to be made. And Jodorowsky's film has never been done. It was David Lynch who did the movie after all. And that's why I think, you know, most of what I will say, it will be much more relevant to Arab futurism, but I think it's a comment also, you know, on futurism in general. So I think basically that Arab futurism is still lacking its founding fathers, like its founding novel, you know? Because as we saw, Dune like influenced much of the creation of sci-fi that came after it and allowed much of it. Arab futurism and Arab sci-fi still lacks a founding novel. Now this is from quite an acute magazine. Lama introduced me to it. It's called Kahwa magazine. And here we see a kind of play with, again, with the desert as an element in an Arab futurist text. Now this is poetry, which is an Arab ancient art, and it's done in a futuristic mood, but most, like the title, gives the most of it, you know? It's a diasporic love poems from elsewhere. And this is much to say about the Arab futurism nowadays, because most of the Arab futurism nowadays is produced in the diaspora, and it is produced mostly in English. But it varies, like, and it differs from in different, like it has different layers and different themes or different genres even. I liked the differentiation Rinaldo did between Arab futurism and Gulf futurism. I think they are related, but it's a bit different, and I will show why, and I'll try to show why. But this element of the desert and the Arab in the desert and coming from the desert to the most technological places on Earth, even though it's, you know, it's a natural feeling to anybody landing in New York, but I think these themes are very prominent even in nowadays Arab futurism. The real issue is whether indeed there can be a true representation of anything, yeah? Or whether any and all representations, because they are representation, are embedded first in the language and then in the culture, institution, and political ambience of the representative. If the later alternative is the correct one, as I believe it is, then we must be prepared to accept the fact that a representation is eo ipso implicated, intertwined, embedded, interwoven with a great many other things besides the truth, which is itself a representation. Now, I do believe that it's really hard to represent a culture, it's really hard to represent other culture, and it's even pretty hard to write yourself, yeah? But as other people, like I don't remember how to quote that easily, But writing the past or writing the future is all the time rewriting the past or rewriting the future, yeah? So I think the main thing which I want to focus on from this quote is the political ambience, the language, culture, institution, and political ambience of the representator. Because again, if we come back, so why is Arab futurism lacking its founding novel? I think this thing is mainly what I'm expecting from Arab artists to be more, you know? Like, I think it's the role of movements to create proper ways of representation of and of rewriting cultural concepts. In other words, and in this quote, if we say that astro-blackness, in which a person's black state of consciousness, released from the confining and crippling slave or colonial mentality, becomes aware of the multitude and varied possibilities and probabilities with the universe. And I think the situation in which most of the Arab futurism is created in a relation or in a deep relationship with the Western Christendom, we will still be lacking the ability to make people aware of the multitude and varied possibilities and probabilities with the universe. Now, let's go back, yeah? Not to futurism, but to children book illustrations during the 80s. This is from a book called Kashkul al-Rassam, Kashkul the Painter. It's basically an illustrator called Illabadi, who's trying to explain to children different complexities in an illustrator life, or the different conflict that an illustrator in the Arabic world meets while he tries to illustrate children's books. As you see here, he explains why did he stop using the flesh color when illustrating people? Because he says it was easy. We were buying it, we were using it, but after a long while, I couldn't ignore that it doesn't look like my hands when I'm painting, and it doesn't look like the flesh color of my family. And that's why I stopped using it and started mixing my own flesh color each time I paint humans. On the other page, he explains the first time he discovered that superheroes in Western culture goes from left to right, while superheroes or, you know, classical oriental figures goes from right to left. And then he like understood that we go by different linearities, like the story goes from right to left in Arabic, also the illustration goes from left to right in English, and not only the text. And here he explains the moments that he starts discovering classic Islamic miniatures, and how this brought him into conflict of how the world should look like. So how am I portraying this superhero? Does he have to look like Superman and Batman, or should I illustrate him like Salah al-Din? How would I portray, or how would I illustrate a historical figure? Should I take it as a continuation of the miniatures? Should it be, you know, a continuation from the art school, which he probably did in the West? And he tried to explain to children the conflict in and the various ways heroes are illustrated in children's books. And here, He explains the first time he encountered, while looking at the old scripts and the miniatures, the first time he encountered the Idrisi map. Do you know about the Idrisi map? It's one of the oldest Islamic maps found, around 1000 AD, and it's portrayed while the south, while you're facing the south, not facing the north in the map. You know, because Mecca, you pray to Mecca, so it's in the south. So they used to draw maps facing the south, like the world is upside down. This is a close-up where you have, you know, Africa is on the right, East Africa is actually here, you know? It's the other way around. Now, while looking at the Kahwa magazine, I saw this this work by an artist called Mohine Hewa. She's a French and she's from a mixed background. Her mother is Algerian Egyptian and her father is a South Asian. And I don't know if she did it by chance or deliberately, you know. But I loved the way she used mapping. If you see, the map of North Africa is upside down and it's looking south. And I think it's a great comment on what is mapping and what's the cultural world you come to illustrate things from. And not always, not only, you know, looking at the fashion of it, of how being an Arab or desert, of course, even here is pretty dominant, but the idea of mapping differently catched my attention. This is another map of the journey of Nasser Khosrow from North Khorasan, Persia today, to the Holy Lands and Egypt. And as you see, the place we are talking from right now, the place we live in this map, is actually West Asia. It's not exactly the Middle East. And this is a point, another point I would like to illustrate as being outside of the Western Christendom. You know, also the geographical awareness of where do you create art and to whom do you create art, and what are your geographical boundaries and what are your geographical encounters, yeah? What creates your world when you talk about art or futurism? So I think understanding that we are Western Asia and not the Middle East is one of the main points in the subject. Now, in many Arab futurist work, the Arab is placed in a sci-fi apocalypse surrounding. You know, it's a post-apocalypse, apocalyptic surrounding, disasters, and of course, it's a very symbolic to the Arab region nowadays, yeah? Like, I don't expect a Palestinian-Syrian artist not to use this theme. I'm just gonna comment on the theme in general. And in another note, I love all the work I'm exhibiting today, and this is really one of the best of them. It's Ayham Jaber's work last year in Gallery P21 in London. But on another hand, this use of the theme keeps us with no agency, yeah? With total passiveness, with a very folklorist Arab figures, and trapped in a human rights discourse, a victimhood discourse. It's all the time the refugee Arab in an apocalyptic surrounding, you know, and it feels all the time it's victimhood, simple, you know, and this feeling of no agency is a bit tricky when we're talking about futuristic art. Because as I said before, I expect futuristic art to create agency, to create imagination, and to pull things further than just the dissonance and the feeling of you know, strangeness that comes with a futuristic feeling. No doubt, no matter what, state control will keep with us, and I think, like I also expect, and I think, you know, the increasing control of the state will stay with us no matter if it was an Oriental state, a Russian state, or a Western state. The control and surveillance certainly will stay some of the main themes. Now, I want to have one comment on this kind of futuristic art in general, and especially when they are done here. This is an image from Larissa Sansour's work, Palestinauts. She creates many little Palestinian astronauts. Now, I think this theme, in general, is great to illustrate why there is no political agency or in the Palestinian or the Turkish or the Arab in world nowadays in general. Of course, it gives us a great opportunity to tackle masculinity, national heritage. You know, when you create a mission to the moon, you'll have the speeches, the marches, the flags. You'll tackle all of this modern state building issues and masculinity and all of this stuff, but it won't give with it a very, you know, I don't think it will bring with it much agency to the people consuming this art. Now I wanted to show you another project which deals with the Palestinian Space Agency, which just by being more simplistic and done in a more like an art project, it's done by a Swiss artist. It's called Gil Frontlet, if I'm pronouncing his name right. And he did it in Amman and in Palestine. And I think it's great because I myself believe, like was looking for 3 years for the person who did it. Because he did this, you know, he just did this website and this Facebook page and started collecting, like he had his crew in Amman, yeah? But through waste, they started creating this little artifacts of spaceships and playing with the idea of creating the spaceship. And you could see a real picture of people going to garbage things and bring, you know. So it was also dealing with waste, also giving children opportunities to, you know, play with the theme, and also building the most Jordanian website ever. Yeah? Which makes it really believable. You really look at it and you start thinking, who the hell, who's this Jordanian who did this? Now, another question which I have about Arab futurism, and I think Rinaldo touched it a bit further, is why don't we have Western aliens or monsters in Arab futurism? Like, why are we restrained by this politically correct discourse? Because we won't get any funds, yeah? The answer is obvious. But why don't we have any Western aliens or monsters in the creation of modern Arab futurism? On the other hand, this is Fatima Al-Qadiri, Vatican vibes video. And what I love about Gulf futurism and Fatima Al-Qadiri and Safiya Al-Maria basically is the variety and agency of their work. And I agree that it's that's it. I can't see people with abaya walking the mall anymore. It's too much. It's been used too much. But when you look at Gulf futurism, suddenly there is some agency to the work these girls do. And it's not done by some victimhood, and it's not done totally politically correct, not all the time. And they can address also the Islamic, you know, mythological, urban mythology about the Vatican controlling the world, having some agencies and producing really good video gaming about it. And on the other hand, putting the West or the Western Christendom as the object of the work of art. Yeah? So that's great. Like, I didn't see many Arab artists who does that. Funds, you know? Now, I wanted to show you this video as a comment on neoliberalism, but I really advise you. I think this Sofia Almeria taking the soundtrack from Fatima Al-Qadri's How Can I Resist You? A love poem to London. Yeah, this is how you say London in Gulf accent. So it's a love poem to London. And I think one of the other aspects that's great about the way these two ladies do art is how good they address the state of neoliberalism in the Arab world nowadays, and especially in the Gulf area. How they deal with the feminist issues, male-only parties with dancers, and lots of other themes. But it's obviously that the Gulf is too easy to think about in a science fiction you know, perspective, because it is skyscrapers meeting the desert. Like, it costed probably much more than a Hollywood production, but it is much more real than any sci-fi you know, art ever done. It's skyscrapers in the middle of the desert and a sea. And mall culture, staying at home because of atmosphere conditions, more use of the internet and video games. And that's why I think Art Dubai is one, like Futurism have, I don't think there was any other city in the area that dealt with Futurism more than Dubai. And it fits the city, yeah? But of course, it brings with it all the problems of foreign workers, modern slavery, neoliberalism, and a very weird mixture between neoliberalism and religion. Yeah, this is pretty an old photo. Nowadays, you see much more skyscrapers around the holiest place of Islam. Yeah, and I think this is another. This is another thing which I like about Gulf Futurism is that it is Western Asian in the way it deals with the economical issues that the Gulf have with the Asian workers, with modern slavery. It deals with religious aspects. All the things that modern art in a secular Western Christendom doesn't allow an Arab or a Muslim artist to feel free about, you know? But the other thing is most of the things are in the aspect of the futures here, because the landscape is already sci-fi in the UAE. It does deal with neoliberal economics pretty good, and that's what I like about Larissa Sansour's work that we saw now. I think it's a great comment on the Palestinian Authority and the neoliberal situation lived now in the West Bank. I love the fact that we see Arabs who are not refugees. It deals with religious themes. It deals with Islamic motives and a critical eye inward the Arab society, and not all the time a victimhood portrayed in the West, you know, like this charity relationships with the West. On the other hand, I don't want to sound like I'm promoting neither self-orientalism, neither reverse orientalism, neither an anti-Christian agenda regarding it towards the West. If there was much more time to address this, I probably could have explained much more in depth. How these things give us a picture, and to conclude, what I expect Arab art to be is to deal more with Islamic history, because I think, you know, technology is it's a global thing. Like dealing with human technology and the possibilities it gives us, it is a human, it is a global thing, even though I do expect Arab artists to deal more with it, also in the violent meaning of it, you know? Because again, like I think, like this, I feel, you know, it's just most of the modern Arab art is just too polite to break funding boundaries. That's why I expect it also to be beyond human rights discourse. Like, I don't know the hell if the modern liberal state is the fantasy I want to live. Yeah? And I don't think that is what futuristic art should deal with. Like, I don't think, like, I should think of other condition. I want futuristic art to portray other dimension and to bring other ideas. And not all the time to deal with the modern liberal state as, you know, the highest of our ambitions. Now, I do think it's crucial to embrace the diaspora expressions inward, yeah? Because I think one of the turmoils that are very dangerous in the Arab world, that all the time the definition of identity is done in a negative, you know, in a eliminating way. We are not Western, so you keep eliminating elements, eliminating elements, eliminating elements. You remain with the fundamentals, and that's it. You're a fundamentalist. Yeah? So it's a very dangerous situation. But I do think I want to restrain the lure of the Western harem pleasures, yeah? Because I think, in a way, it's hard to think about Berlin, Manhattan, New York, or whatever, as the palace of the Ottoman Sultan that has many women, drinks, and very much pleasures. But I think that's basically what the liberal West doesn't like to see it as is, as that. And I think that creates a very disturbed relationship between East and West, because like suddenly all of the aspiration and all of the ambition is to be part of this party, yeah? Without all of the implications of entering the castle, who's standing outside of the doors, who's outside of the walls, who's enjoying the palace, who's not, and without overthinking the politics this situation creates. And I think that's it. I want to finish with Fatima Al-Qadri's cover for her latest album. It's called Asiatic. Now, it's called Asiatic because it's Asiatic, but in the Gulf, and also in my hometown, Taipei, we pronounce K at the end of the word with H. From Qatar and living in Brooklyn, she is closer to my childhood than any other Arab artist I know. Yeah? So that's Asiatic. That's it. Question.
I like your concept of that, the Western Asia concept, because I know other people I know are talking about Europe being like the back end of Asia when you think of the entire land mass. So how does that deal with the cross-cultural concept, say, for those Muslims and Arabs east of that line you were talking about, West Asia, going over to Morocco, in terms of how they relate to that?
That's a good question. I have this microphone.
One more.
A Zoe question for you. I'm surprised you didn't mention ISIS as a sci-fi project, because it is absolutely.
I had this.
So I wonder what you think.
Yeah, I wanted to use also Zionism and ISIS as the most futuristic projects in the Middle East. They are. other questions?
Anyone else?
Now, how does North African Arabs or Muslim feel with the concept of Western Asia? I think they doesn't feel they are Western Asia. I think they feel more and more with the years. Like, I think they feel more and more they're Africans. And you have, you know, Berbers, very outspoken nowadays in North Africa. So it does shift when you go to North Africa, because there, some people feel they are Muslim, they want to bring more Muslim identities, but they want to reduce the Arab identity because they don't feel Arab, but they feel belonging to the Muslim world. But all in all, I think Western Asia is much more healthy concept. Also, to think about the upcoming China, yeah? And not all the time to be, you know, late to the party. Not all the time to be late to the party. Sometime just to arrive early, for Christ's sake. On another hand, it has much more to do with like the philosophy of the region, the history of the region, the theology of it. Like northern Iran, like it's not by chance, this is the politics that, like my other comment was, if to move to ISIS and fundamentalist Islam, is that this is actually the politics that are shaping the region, you know? Like, we're stuck with the Western Christendom, and we are thinking about all of this secular world, you know? There was the end of the Ottoman Empire, and then came the British, and then started colonialism. Who the hell cares? There's a religious war going on, you know? And, you know, like, you're dealing with the Zionist project. Like, these guys are thinking they're going to build the temple, you know? Like, who the hell are we talking this secular discourse? Like, how much does this count anyhow, you know? And, you know, then, and regarding, you know, the religious discourse, you know, then comes Bibi, stands in at Trump's conference and say, you know why Jews are called Jews? Because they are the native of Judea, yeah? It's a total change of genetics, nativeness, like it's a sci-fi produced in a presidential conference. And then comes Trump and says, yeah, of course I don't have anything against the Jews. My daughter is Jewish, and I have Jewish grandchildren. And boom, Ivanka Trump is a native of Judea. You know? It's boom. Like, you know, if Ivanka Trump is Jewish, if Jews are the native of Judea, then you have it. I'm standing here without full political rights, and Ivanka Trump is a native of Judea. You know? So it's like, it's crazy around here, yeah? And that's why I think, like, these are the politics that will shape the tomorrow even more. Or if I want to talk with art that is more related to my cousin in Taipei, then, like, I should read more Islamic philosophy or something. That's on one hand. Now, do I think ISIS are a science fiction dystopian... Or utopian. Certainly apocalyptic, yeah? Whether utopian or dystopian, that's another question. Well, I think, you know, when I wanted to use the Dune, like I did want to say about that probably nowadays, with all of us speaking this secular discourse, like what I'm thinking about lately is that probably Islamists are the only revolutionaries around. Because, like, we are all reformists in somehow, yeah? Let's admit it. Like, we are all just want a little fixes in this Western Christendom. We are even too afraid of China. We're not really ready for a change in the future, yeah? These Islamists are the only renegades outside of this, like outside of this empire in a way, yeah. And in another, like as I said, I do think they are the, you know, the mutation of reductive Arabic identity, you know? I do think they are a big mutation of the modern Arab project, but...
They were very creative.
Yeah. In that. And they are a great visual artist. Yeah, like, let's admit it, you know? Like, they do know the job. Like, regarding visual art, they're pretty good visual artists, unfortunately. But that's, I don't know.
Anyone else? Okay, there's a lot to think about. Thank you.
You're welcome.